greatest disruptor of all time is actually COVID-19. Because of limited mobility, people are also not being able to go to physical branches, etc. So it further accelerated the adoption of consumers of digital channels. We are now being able to provide the services needed by our citizens, by our consumers.
Mobility will be key to recovery because we have relaxed some of our quarantine methods, no? And
good morning, I'm Mike Navalio.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman.
Join us as we give you the rundown of the news you need to know today. In the headlines, Presidential Peace Advisor Carlito Galvez Jr. appointed as Philippine Defense Secretary after Acting Chief Jose Faustino Jr. resigns.
A Quezon City Court jumps a perjury case filed by former National Security Advisor Hermogenes Esperon Jr. against 10 human rights activists.
Philippine House lawmakers set to begin today its hearing into the air travel mess on New Year's Day.
And over 1,000 people are arrested in Brazil as security forces crack down on anti-government protests.
Thanks for joining us. We begin with a major shakeup in the Philippine Defense Department. President Marcos Jr. appoints his peace advisor, Carlito Galvez Jr., as defense secretary after Acting Chief Jose Faustino Jr. resigned. The resignation came amid alleged unrest within the armed forces of the Philippines, whose chief was replaced last week after just 5 months of occupying the post. The Defense Department thanked Faustino for his service and also expressed its confidence in Galvez's leadership, citing his experience as a military commander and vaccine chief in the previous administration. The armed forces echoed the DND's statements, adding his experience will help sustain the country's gains in peace and security. And joining us to help us make sense of what's going on within the Defense Department is former Senator and former Armed Forces Chief of Staff, General Rodolfo Biazon. General Biazon, good morning. Welcome to the program. General, I think you're still on mute. We're trying to fix the audio of General Rodolfo Biazon as we're trying to get his statements, his remarks, his comments on what's going on in the Defense Department and Air Forces. Good morning, General Biazon.
Hi, good morning, Mike. Good morning, Nikki, and everyone.
All right, General, thank you so much for your time with us this morning. But General, what's happening? The shakeup of the armed forces of the Philippines and the Department of National Defense, they've fueled coup rumors over the weekend. So as far as you know, is there a coup brewing?
This situation requires a lot of clear answers, you know, or it will help to continue the chaos or confusion. You know, this is the first time that this thing has happened to these armed forces of the Philippines and to the country, where you remove one chief of staff, set him to floating, and then replace him with another, and then eventually you remove again this one and then get back or assign back the one that you relieve in the first place, in the first place. So this is the first time that this happens. But I would like to assuage the fears of some people about the possibility of a destabilization. I don't think a destabilization in the level of what happened to President Cory Aquino or President Arap or President Arroyo can happen. Because number one, there is no rallying issue that can be used as it was before, number one. But the most important thing is there is no more the brand of thinking of some soldiers before. Wala na ngayon yan eh. And I think the present crop of officers and men of the armed forces abide by what they have sworn to, yung kanilang duty. So, hindi mangyayari yung nangyayari nung kay President Cory, President Arap, President Arroyo eventually. But this thing is therefore raising a so many questions. Number one, is Baccaro covered by the new Republic Act? Republic Act 11706, where it is giving a fixed term for officers in the armed forces, starting from the chief of staff plus seven other officers. Are they covered? Was Baccaro covered? So the problem is, if he was covered, there must be given a reason why he was removed, meaning General Baccaro. In the first place, there was not enough explanation on the removal of General Centeno.
There was no explanation at all.
Yeah, General Baccaro is supposed to be to have been retirable in September last year. And General Centeno is going to retire or is retirable mandatorily under the old law in for February yet, one month more. So what are the reasons for this rigodon? This is the first time that this thing has happened, as I said, no? You remove one chief of staff without plausible reasons being given, replace it with another, and then you remove this another, and then restore the other one. So this is a very confusing issue. And as I said, it's raising a lot of questions.
General,
one question is, when Go is ahead, the General. New law? When is the new law effective? 11706.
I believe you're referring to General 11709. RA
11709, yes. So that provides for a fixed term. Of course, under the practices and other certain laws, the president, as the the appointing authority, retains the so-called hire and fire power. And I don't think that has been changed yet, the hire and fire power of the president. We had a when I was still in the Senate, proposed the fixed term, a fixed term law. I asked for a definition of the hire and power, president of the president. Of course, Senator Joker Arroyo, rest his soul, you know. May he rest in peace, stated that it is very, very difficult to define the limitations of the hire and fire power of the president. Kaya nandiyan pa yan, it is retained, And so therefore, we have to hear good and plausible reasons, the removal of Centeno and then the removal of Bacaro, mm-hmm. and then explain also why it is Centeno who is replacing Bacaro. Now, mm-hmm. the question is, if I think Centeno is already covered by the new law, mm-hmm. you know, although he's retiring next month, according to the law, he is fixed term of 3 years, meaning last Saturday should be the reckoning date when you count the 3 years, according to the law.
Not the first time he was appointed as general. So the three-year period for his appointment as AFP chief of staff is not counted the first time he was appointed?
Then there is another question. Centeno, General Centeno, had been given an appointment as ambassador to India.
Mm.
And insofar as the commission appointment is concerned, dalawa ang appointment ni Centeno. One, ambassador to India, and second, as Chief of Staff of the Armed Forces of the Philippines. So, kung ako ang commission appointment, I will be confused.
Mm-hmm.
As it is now a fact that many people are confused. For example, there is a concern in the Philippine National Police about a supposed memorandum
mm-hmm.
getting the certain units of the PNP on red alert because of this issue. Mm-hmm. Ngayon, iniimbestigahan niya tayan. Ano? So, meaning, if some government agencies are confused, paano tayo?
Mm-hmm.
But there's a question. There's a question.
Certainly not.
Baka itong confusion na ito will result in chaos.
Mm-hmm.
And we cannot confuse the armed forces of the Philippines. Halimbawa, yan, ngayon, nag-resign si Secretary of Defense.
Mm-hmm.
Nilagay si General Galvez. I have no issue about that. The only issue is, what was the reason of General Faustino in resigning?
Mm-hmm.
What was the reason? Mm-hmm. Because things must be clear to the soldiers down there on the ground. Bakit sinuha nag-resign ito? May dahilan. Ano yung dahilan na yan? So there is a lot of questions to be asked and to be answered.
General,
and the basic is kailan ba effective talaga yung bagong batas? Yung 11709. Kailan ba effective yan? Kasi kung effective na yan, and the report is that General Bacaro would be the first chief of staff covered by that law. Meaning, may additional 3 years siya under that law. Ngayon, nirelieve mo. Kailangan maliwanag ang dahilan. Bakit mo nirelieve?
Mm-hmm. General,
one of the reasons
that has been floated why this was what happened is because supposedly there's no implementing rules and regulations yet of RA 11709. Is that sufficient reason for not following the fixed 3-year term?
Okay, but the question is, the law is supposed to be effective 16 days after its enactment.
Mm-hmm.
So what is the reason kung bakit wala pa yung IRR?
Mm-hmm.
Somebody somewhere committed a lapse of judgment.
Mm-hmm. General, how do you think this will affect the entire AFP structure? You did allude to it earlier, but you have a very hierarchical system in the armed forces of the Philippines. So what happens to the morale of the men under, I mean, at least the officers immediately who were expecting to succeed General Baccaro, but they now had to wait because you have General Centino back and it's not clear if he's going to serve the full three-year term.
That is the reason why I insist and I say that there must be plausible, clear reasons why these things are happening. Remember, I said, this is the first time that this thing happened to the armed forces of the Philippines. There was an incident before that a chief of staff was relieved before his retirement, mandatory retirement. Isa lang yan, ano? And pero ito, ibang klase ito eh. Kasi tinanggal mo yung isa, binalik mo yung isa, ngayon tinanggal mo na naman yung isa, ibinalik mo yung isa. So, this is a lot of confusion. And there must be plausible, clear and plausible reasons why these things are happening. And we need to hear from the appointing authority.
General, I just want to go into the relationship between Yusek Jose Faustino, General Faustino, and General Centino. They were supposed to be classmates, right? So, but General Faustino was absent during the resumption of General Centino to the top post of the AFP.
Exactly.
And then later on, it appears that he has resigned and the president has accepted his resignation. Are you aware of any conflict between the two?
What was that again?
Are you aware of any conflict between General Centino and General Faustino?
No. And I assume there is none. Because a statement from a functionary in Malacañang says that the relief of Centino was a mistake. So the question is, paano nangyari ito? Is this some lapse of judgment? But the only problem is that if there is this lapse of judgment, it must be clarified. So ang question, saan ba nanggali itong balita na ito? Ngayon tinatanggi na ng PNP na mayroong memorandum setting the some units of the PNP on red alert because of the possibility of a destabilization move. Totoo ba ito o totoo? So that, a lot of questions have to be answered. And the answers must clarify the situation. Kasi what we cannot have is a confused armed forces of the Philippines.
Mm-hmm. General, you mentioned that the appointment was supposedly of the relief of General Centino was supposedly a mistake. There are talks that reinstalling him as AFP Chief of Staff is correct what happened to him. But of course, there are talks that this has something to do with the former Executive Secretary, Vic Rodriguez, who supposedly was instrumental in appointing Lieutenant General Baccaro to the post.
Yes.
So if this is true, are we seeing the politicization of the armed forces of the Philippines if the appointments are based on who is the sitting executive secretary or who are the officials in Malacañang and they can just tinker with the appointments in the armed forces of the Philippines?
Okay, let's go back to a basic and fundamental practice or legal provision. The definition of the higher and fire power of the president. This is, I think, the one that is being invoked on this situation. But you cannot just do what has been done without creating confusion. And the worst agency to be confused is the man with the gun. The man with the gun. Kailangan maliwanag lahat sa kanila. Of course, there is a fundamental principle of the belief and probably culture, if I may say so, no, of the armed forces of the Philippines and the police that the commander-in-chief is the one that determines everything. Commander-in-chief. But there is the question, paano nangyari ito?
And
kasi
he was absent.
Mas maganda pa siguro kung, alam mo, kung mas maganda pa siguro mangyari, this situation will not be as confused as this, it is today. You know? If, kung ayaw ni Presidente o appointing authority kay Bakaro, hindi dapat ibinalik si Santino.
Mm-hmm.
Pumili na lang ng iba. Mm-hmm. Kasi ito, paano mo i-explain niya? Tinanggal mo, pinalitan mo. Yung nagpumalit, pitinanggal mo, ibinalik mo yung tinanggal mo muna.
Mm-hmm.
This is the one that is creating the question, the situation, or the chaos. Hindi walang dapat na i-explain except the removal of Bakaro.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, the president has the power to hire and fire. But because of the importance of the positions, there must be plausible reasons why you are removing the leader of that agency.
Mm-hmm. In the absence, General, of any explanation, there have been talks about the possible reason for the removal of Lieutenant General Bakaro. And they're citing the rift between supposedly the former ES Victor Rodriguez and the First Lady Liza Araneta Marcos. Supposedly, this is a purging of the appointments done under ES Rodriguez. And it's not just happening in the DND and the AFP, but it's also happening in other agencies. So, from your point of view, how is the First Lady Liza Araneta Marcos involved in this issue? Because she had to put out a video statement saying she does not interfere in the appointments. But if she finds out that someone is using her name, she will tell her husband not to appoint that person. So why did she have to make that particular video statement? What does that tell you, General?
If it has something to do with the personalities, though, mm-hmm. causing this confusion, I am not aware mm-hmm. of the personal reasons. And I would not like to venture into that. Let it be. If they want to explain it, they explain it. But I'm not going to pursue the question on
I
the
understand.
Issue. But eto ngayon.
Mm-hmm.
Sabi ko nga, the armed forces of the Philippines, the Philippine National Police, must not be put in confusing situation. Because that's dangerous. You know, mm-hmm. kung confused yung may hawak ng baril, may problema tayo. So, mm-hmm. All of this thing must be clarified. The question is, ito bang news na ito, kung totoo na wala naman yung memorandum ng PNP, putting certain PNP units under red alert because of the situation, ano ba yun? Wala daw eh. Pero eh, bakit lumabas yung balita? So, ang tanong ganito, itong mga nangyayaring ito, which are producing confusion, not only with the soldiers and policemen, but mas lalo na tayo, no? Nakukumpiyos tayo. Is this speculative fake news? Fake news ba ito? Kung fake news ito, sino naglabas ito at for what reason? Dapat malaman natin yun. Now, however, the worst thing that should be erased is there a politicization of the military? May politicization ba sa military? Again, I would like to believe that wala. All of this is as a result of lapse of judgments.
By whom?
Answer the question. I think you. Kasi my answer will also be speculative.
Mm-hmm.
And the dangerous thing about speculation is it can be used by anyone.
Yes, but General,
or against the government.
All right, but it's the president who clearly has the appointing authority here. Shouldn't he be the one making the explanation? And what does his absence last Saturday tell you?
Kaya nga eh. Halimbawa, first time na, I would say, in a major turnover ceremony, the top gun of the agency should have been there.
Mm-hmm.
Bakit wala siya dun? What is the reason? And why was this turnover held in almost in secret?
Mm-hmm.
Bakit? Kasi it is normally during turnovers na ganyan, madidinig natin ano ba ang proposal ng bagong leader ng agency. Mm-hmm. He will have to spell it out. Like when I retired as chief of staff in 1991, ang tanong ko eh, co-baddish soldiers, where are we going?
Mm-hmm.
Because of the confusion of the time. Although the confusion of the time is not the same as the confusion today.
Mm-hmm.
Luckily for us, I think the armed forces of the Philippines is so professionalized that it doesn't matter sino ang nasa taas.
Mm-hmm.
Provided that yung nasa taas hindi kinukonfuse yung nasa ibaba.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say ito, na the confusion of the Cory regime, the Arab regime, the Arroyo regime, insofar as the armed forces stabilization functions in society is concerned, wala ngayon yan.
Wala but ngayon. Is this somehow related to the PNP courtesy resignation issue? Because that has also created some confusion among the PNP, among the police.
And that's another matter, you know, that must be clarified. Why do you ask the whole command to submit courtesy resignation? Why? There are procedures. There are agencies that addresses the question of corruption or malfeasance, misfeasance in the organization. Merong ano yan eh. Merong mga organization yan. So why do you replace that with asking the whole command to submit resignation? You put everyone in doubt. Pagka ganun. So that's another issue, that's a separate issue anyway, that should be clarified.
General,
much resignation.
As a final note, how do you think all of these confusion, whether in the PNP or the AFP or the DND, how do you think these should be resolved?
A simple explanation and a simple adherence to legal processes. Legal processes. Kaya nga eh, na-confuse tayo eh. Tinanggal si General Centeno, pinalutang-lutang, ano? He was put in floating status. Inilagay mo si General Bacaro. After a while, without a simple explanation, except the explanation of Executive Secretary Rodriguez, na, so ano ngayon, pinaglalaruan ba natin ang armed forces of the Philippines? Which is causing the confusion. There must be a plausible and credible explanation to these events, to these happenings, so to speak. We need to hear the explanation and give them the chance to explain this.
And General, just one more question, because this is an issue with the PNP, that there are supposedly some generals involved in the illegal drug trade. Are there also members of the AFP, whether officers or personnel, involved in the illegal drug trade, as far as you know?
Wala na eh. Kasi the last, although meron pa na graduates from the military who joined the PNP. ano, meron pa yan eh. Dati, ang PNP was under, or Constabulary was under the Armed Forces of the Philippines. Ano? Eh ngayon, hindi na ganun eh. Since 1991, wala nang graduate sa PMA na na-assign sa PNP.
I'm actually asking general involvement in the illegal drug trade. Are there members of the armed forces of the Philippines who are supposedly involved in illegal drug trade? Drugs.
Well, again, as I said, since nag-separate ang PNP from the armed forces, the PNP has become a civilian agency. And they are not anymore covered by the so-called articles of war. So it is the civilian authority that is, especially Secretary of Interior and Local Government, ang kanilang boss. Hindi na si Secretary ng DND. Hindi na. So iba nang they are operating in terms of standards, ano? Even legal standards, the armed forces of the Philippines and the Philippine National Police are two distinct agencies covered by different legal standards.
That we understand, General.
Magkaiba.
Thank you so much for your time with us this morning. We certainly got a lot of insights from you, from a former chief of staff yourself and a former lawmaker. Thank you so much for joining us this morning, General Rodolfo Biazon.
Thank you.
Moving on to more news now, a Quezon City court junks a perjury case filed by former National Security Advisor Hermenes Esperon Jr. against 10 human rights activists. They include the National Coordinator of Rural Missionaries of the Philippines, the Chairperson and Secretary General of Karapatan, and the Secretary General of Gabriela. Esperon's complaint filed in 2020 claimed that the activists lied under oath in a 2019 writ of amparo petition that the groups filed against him, then-President Rodrigo Duterte, and several other government officials. But the Quezon City Court ruled the prosecution failed to establish beyond reasonable doubt that all accused made a willful and deliberate assertion of a falsehood.
The Philippine House of Representatives, set to begin today, is tearing into the air travel mess on New Year's Day. The Civil Aviation Authority of the Philippines says it's also preparing for a separate hearing by the Senate this coming Thursday. On January 1st, thousands of passengers were affected after the unprecedented failure of GAAP's traffic management system.
We've been working on this the past several days. In fact, sleepless nights. We've been meeting not only with the secretary, with the undersecretary, but the entire staff to give us the updates, to give us the findings, and to make sure that we give accurate information. We will not be holding any information at all. Sa amin lang ilalabas namin kung ano nangyari.
For an aviation industry expert, it's high time to revisit the training program of pilots to make sure they are ready for unexpected air travel disruptions.
It looks like it's an unthinkable scenario, but we still train for it.
Yes.
But now, it seems na hindi siya unthinkable, right? So now, let's make a regular training out of it. Maybe before you just visit this every 3 years, now I think we will have to revisit it every year or every twice a year.
Now here's a look at other stories we're tracking today at 8 in the morning. The Commission on Elections, the Government Service Insurance System, or GSIS, will sign their Memorandum of Agreement for the expansion of their registration process. Brother Cheng will be at the signing. At 12 noon, Meralco will hold a press conference on the adjustment of power rates for 2023. Alvin Alchico will cover that event. At 1 p.m., the Department of Information and Communication Technology will also hold a press conference on the Complaint Center Hotline for SIM card registration, and Jackie Pascual will attend that briefer. And at 2 in the afternoon, the Philippine Central Bank will release its Financial Stability Report for 2022. Juan de Guzman will give us specifics later.
And we are taking a quick break. Up ahead, local onion farmers oppose government's plan to import onions as a way to bring down prices.
And the Energy Department sees power supply issues for the Luzon grid. These and more when the Rundown returns. Stay tuned.
Welcome back to The Rundown. The headlines across the web on Inquirer. Thousands of nurses at two hospitals in New York City go on strike after contract negotiations stalled over pay and staff safety. Philippine Star's top story, the Metro Rail Transit Line 3 and Light Rail Transit Line 2 recorded increases in ridership last year. On Manila Bulletin, President Marcos Jr. vows to improve the country's transportation system. And on news.abs-cbn.com, the Philippines reported over 3,000 new COVID cases in the past week. The Philippines is returning to the global bond market with a $500 million bond offer. The bonds have tenors of 5.5 years. 10.5 years and 25 years. Proceeds from the bond sale will be used for general budget financing. It was in October 2022 when the Philippines launched the first U.S. dollar bond offer under the Marcos Jr. administration.
The Philippine Agriculture Department plans to import onions as the prices of locally grown varieties remain expensive. Agriculture's Assistant Secretary Rex Estuperez says 22,000 metric tons of onions will be imported before February. Now, this aims to bring down the farm gate prices of onions, whose price per kilo averages at 250 pesos. But onion farmers in Nueva Ecija province oppose the importation plan. They point out that this will coincide with their own harvest.
That 222,000 metric tons will be divided dun sa 25% will go to Mindanao. 25% will go to Visayas, and the remaining 50,000 will go dito sa Luzon.
Senator Amy Marcos says she has urged her brother and concurrent agriculture chief, President Marcos Jr., to reevaluate the timing of the importation.
Ang hinihiling na lang natin sa ating Department of Agriculture, kinakailangan natin mag-project, magplano ng konti. Hindi naman pwede itong ura-urada. Alam naman nila ang kinakailangan ng sibuyas sa isang taon. Ilan talaga ang totoo? Huwag naman yung labis-labis.
Philippine Energy Department is seeing thin power reserves for the Luzon grid. The agency also defends its call for demand-side management to ease pressure on the power grid. Avila Chico has the details.
Oil firms have announced a rollback in fuel prices effective Tuesday. Diesel will be lower by 2 pesos and 80 centavos per liter, gasoline by 75 centavos per liter, and kerosene by 210. The Department of Energy says fears of global recession is the main driver in the drop in imported fuel prices.
Meron namang mga reason na para bumaba siya, di ba? Meron ding reason para tumaas. But still, meron pang nangibabaw ngayon yung announcement ng global recession. Kapag global recession at tuloy-tuloy ang pagbaba ng demand, magpossibilidad na magtuloy-tuloy din ang pagbaba ng presyo.
Meanwhile, the Energy Department says based on projections for 2023, there will be no red or yellow alerts in the Mindanao and Visayas power grid. The problem is with the Luzon grid. With a projected forced outage of 500 to 600 megawatts, 8 months of 2023 will have yellow alerts or thin power reserve, which can lead to problems with electricity supply.
Sana wala tayong sudden outage because we have, let's say, one plant na biglang nasira, magkaka-red alert tayo nun, pag-sudden on. Yung sa mga dapat sana ay yellow alert lang, pag sinabayan niya na biglang may nasira na planta, magkaka-red alert tayo.
The DOE pushes for demand-side management to minimize pressure on the power grid.
There are also things that are within our control. So doon sa kaya nating i-control, marami tayong energy efficiency tips, hindi lang sa behavior nga, kundi pati sa pagpili ng appliances, pati sa pagdisenyo ng mga building or mga pag-check, no? Kung saan sumisingaw yung lamig.
Energy Secretary Rafael Otilia defends the government stance in relying on demand-side management instead of erecting and running more power plants to overtake demand.
Hindi natin dapat tingnan yung demand-side management na parang panakip butas lamang. Dapat ito ay nagiging natural element or embedded already in our entire management system.
The DOE says it takes years to build a power facility, while demand-side management, though at the mercy of consumers, has immediate effect. For 2023, the DOE sees more than 1,000 megawatts additional power supply, mainly from solar and coal power plants. Alvin Olchico, ABS-CBN News.
A transport service group is calling on government regulators to be more transparent in granting new slots for ride-hailing services. The appeal was made by Laban TNVS, or Transportation Network Vehicle Services, as new slots are offered for operators and drivers. Let's now talk to Laban TNVS National President, June De Leon. Good morning, Sir June, and thank you for joining us.
Hi, good morning, Ma'am Nikki. Good morning.
Okay, so LTFRB opened po over 4,000 new slots for TNVS. Tell us more about this. How important po ba itong expansion of TNVS na po, especially now na we have this transport crisis?
Yes, ma'am. Napaka-importante po yung pagbubukas ng slots for TNVS ngayon dahil marami pong nawala ng hanap buhay during pandemic time. Maraming nawala ng sasakyan. Pero ngayon, masaya-masaya ang ating mga kababayan na gusto magnegosyo ng TNVS dahil pagkakataon na ulit nilang magnegosyo. Marami pong mga OFW, maraming mga empleyado na bumili ng sasakyan, nag-loan. At ngayon, pagkakataon na po ito na makabawi at magkaroon ulit ng hanap buhay.
Mm-hmm. Eh sir, ilan na po ba sa ngayon ang nakapag-apply? Kasi kahapon po nag-mass application, tama po ba?
Opo, kahapon po may mga 350 plus po na TNVS new owner po ang nagpunta sa Quezon City Circle from 7 a.m. to 12 noon lang po yun. At marami pong mga TNVS din na sa ibang transport network company nagpunta. Katulad ng Grab, meron po silang mga online scheduler. At may mga nagpunta rin po sa office ng Joyride para makakuha ng slot. Napaka-importante po nito, very transparent po ngayon yung ginawa ng LTFRB. At kahapon din pinakita natin na talagang pinipilahan. Dahil yung mga nakaraang slot, 10,000 slots ang ina-open ng LTFRB. Hindi naman din, nauubos yung slots eh. Kaya importante po makita ng ating mga taong bayan kung saan napupunta yung slots, hindi yung ibinibenta.
Mm-hmm. Sir, ano po bang mga requirements para makapag-register bilang isang TNVS? Tapos meron po ba tayong mga bagong requirements na isinali dito?
Ang basic requirements naman dapat ang sasakyan ng ating mga kababayan ay 2020 to 2023 model. Magdadala na po sila ng ORCR, proof of citizenship, at saka yung LTFRB na application form or copies po. Yun lang naman para matanggapin yan ng transport network company. Tapos i-review po ng transport network company yan para i-endorse sa LTFRB para magkaroon sila ng case number at pwede na silang bumiyahe.
Mm-hmm. Tapos hanggang kailan po ba pwedeng mag-apply? Hanggang sa maubos po ba itong mga slots na binuksan?
Yes po. Kung hanggang kailan mag-apply, hanggang maubos ang 4,433, binigyan po ng LTFRB ang Transport Network Company na 100 applicant every day each TNC. So sa tingin ko, dalawa lang kasi ang Transport Network Company na tumatakbo ngayon. Hindi ko alam kung nabigyan pa yung ibang Transport Network Company na hindi na nag-ooperate. So kung dalawa yung Transport Network Company na nag-ooperate ngayon, 200 every day na ang tatanggapin ng LTFRB. So, tatagal siya ng 22 days.
Mm-hmm. Sir, kayo po sa laban TNDS, nag-a-assist din po ba kayo? Dito po sa pag-apply?
Nag-a-assist po kami ng mga documents ng mga kababayan natin na gusto mag-apply for free. Gusto natin pagbinigay ng mga TNBS, new TNBS operators yan sa ENC, dapat kumpleto na. At tututukan natin ito kung paano gagawin nila at kailangan makakuha sila ng slot.
Sir, ano pong ibig sabihin nito para sa ano, sa competition po among yung mga ride-hailing apps po? No? Paano po yung mga fares tataas po ba, bababa po ba? Ano po bang impact niya sa mga may-ari ng TNBS at sa mga sasakay?
Maganda ang impact nito sa mga riding public, sa mga mananakay. Dahil pag dumadami ang supply ng sasakyan, ang tendency ay hindi siya magsa-surge. So mababa lang yung pamasahe. At syempre, magkakaroon ng maraming pagkakataon yung mga ating kababayan na gustong magnegosyo ng TNBS, makapagservisyo sa ating mga mananakay. Mas maraming trabaho ang mabibigay niya. Ito, panalo dito ang driver at saka yung mga mananakay sa ganitong ginawa ng LTFRB.
Mm-hmm. Everybody wins po, no, sir? Let's talk about yung appeal nyo po sa gobyerno. Gusto nyo po ng mas transparent po sana, no, na pag-open itong mga slots. Ano po bang mga issue noon sa noong nakaraan?
Yes, yung mga issue noong nakaraan, sinasabi nila na walang bentahan na nangyayari sa mga slot. Pero ako po, pinapabulaanan ko yan dahil ako po mismo sumama sa entrapment operation sa bentahan ng mga slots para dito sa TNBS. Kaya ngayon po, nakipag-ugnayan tayo sa LTFRB para mawala itong mga bentahan per slots. Kasi ang laki po eh, from 2010 to 20,000-30,000 binibenta nila yung slot. Pero ngayon, binabantayan po natin yan para maibigay sa tamang tao at hindi binibenta itong mga slots ng TNBS.
Mga ganun po palang nangyayari. Ano pa po bang pwedeng gawin ng LTFRB saka ating transport officials tungkol sa mga problema po sa transport system sa Pilipinas? Ano po ba kasing pinaka-sentro nitong problema natin ever since sa transportation?
Yung problema natin sa transportasyon, kitang-kita naman. Pumunta lang kayo sa EDSA tuwing rush hour, makikita nyo, napaka-traffic. Yung mga kababayan natin nakapila, walang masakyan. Dapat yan ang sinusolusyonan ng ating gobyerno. Ngayon, ibabalik nila ulit ang libreng sakay. Maganda po yan, pero sana yung libreng sakay ay ilagay nila doon sa mga hindi tatamaan yung mga public utility vehicle. Tulad dati, may mga libreng sakay nilalagay dito sa area ng kalayaan. Ang daming mga sasakyan diyan, ang daming jeep diyan na tinamaan ng libreng sakay na imbis na pasahero na ng mga pampasaherong jeep, natatamaan sila ng mga libreng sakay ng ating gobyerno. So, dapat ilagay sa lugar ang mga libreng sakay.
Kaposisyonin din po ng kama para wala naman pong naagrabyado. Okay, thank you po, sir. Thank you so much for joining us this morning po. You stay safe.
Salamat. Mabuhay po kayo.
In foreign news, some 1,500 people are arrested as Brazilian security forces crack down on massive anti-government protests. Hundreds of soldiers and police were mobilized Monday to dismantle an improvised protest camp outside the army's headquarters in Brasilia. That camp was used as a base by thousands of supporters of former President Jair Bolsonaro as they ransacked the presidential palace, Congress building, and Supreme Court on Sunday. President Luiz Inácio Lula da Silva condemned what he's called acts of terrorism. Bolsonaro was narrowly defeated by Lula in the second round of the presidential election last October. Meanwhile, the former president is reportedly admitted to a hospital in Florida in the latest in a series of health problems stemming from a stabbing attack in 2018.
Russia continues to pound eastern Ukraine with deadly strikes. At least 2 are dead and 6 people are injured in a rocket assault on a village market in the Kharkiv region. One person was also killed in Kherson following a strike on a residential area recently recaptured by Ukrainian forces. Kyiv says fierce battles are also taking place in the city of Bakhmut in the Donbas region.
China stages fresh military exercises near Taiwan. Taipei's defense ministry said it detected 57 Chinese aircraft near the South-ruled island on Monday. This is Beijing's second military exercise around Taiwan in less than a month. China's armed forces says the drills seek to test its combat capabilities and counter provocative actions from Taiwan. Taipei has strongly condemned the drills, saying it threatens the stability of the Taiwan Strait. China has ramped up military and economic pressure on Taiwan to force it to accept its claim on the island.
A strong 7.6 magnitude earthquake hit deep under the ocean off Indonesia and East Timor early Tuesday. The U.S. Geological Survey reports the epicenter of the quake was 427 kilometers south of the Indonesian island of Ambon and at a depth of 95 kilometers. The quake was felt as far as Darwin, the capital of Australia's Northern Territory. Indonesia's geophysics agency has recorded aftershocks at a magnitude of 5.5. A tsunami warning was issued but has since been lifted. There have been no reports of damage or victims so far.
And let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now with Bureau Chief TJ Manotok.
Good morning, Mike and Nikki. Here are the latest stories making the headlines amongst the Filipino community.
I will well and faithfully discharge the duties upon
We begin in Sacramento, California, where Rob Bonta has officially become the first Filipino-American elected to serve as Attorney General for the state of California. Bonta was historically appointed by Governor Gavin Newsom in 2020 when his predecessor, Javier Becerra, was called by President Joe Biden to serve in his cabinet as Secretary of Health and Human Services. In the elections last November, Bonta defeated Republican challenger Nathan Hochman by nearly 2 million votes.
It's been a busy 2 years because I believe now more than ever we need leaders in government and law enforcement who will build bridges with our communities. And today, the people of California have an attorney general who is doing just that.
Bonta previously served as an assembly member from Alameda, the highest position ever held by a Filipino-American in California until now.
No Filipino-American had ever served in our state legislature, and certainly not at the helm of the nation's largest state Department of Justice. But that is why the California dream is so potent.
Meanwhile, it's been 2 years of grief for Maya Minette's family. This past weekend in Chula Vista, California, the community held a memorial hike for the missing Phil-Am mother at a local trail that she would frequent.
It gives us joy. I know it's like an overwhelming feeling that we still have this much support from the community. We feel really blessed that a lot of people are supporting us after 2 years.
The 39-year-old mom went missing on January 7, 2021. Search efforts had gone on regularly as investigators kept close watch on the case. On November of 2021, Maya's husband Larry, father of their three children, was arrested and charged with her presumed murder. He has been in custody since and denies the allegations. The preliminary hearings for Larry will begin on Wednesday.
Closure is the number one thing that we're looking for. Finding her, getting answers, and then maybe we can move on.
And finally, Filipino-Canadians in Halifax, Nova Scotia enjoy the Night of Laughter headlined by comedian Jobert Austria. Austria, who made a career for himself in Philippine show business, has been living in Canada since 2019. He entertained the crowd with his funny observations about life in Canada.
Merong mga Pinoy na pagdating ko rito sa basketball, tinanong ko kung Pilipino. Pilipino ba? Sabi niya, excuse me? Indian, hindi na nagtatagalog. Pagtingin ko, dalawang linggo pa lang pala rin.
Austria admitted he got cold feet from doing stand-up comedy several years before, but now feels more comfortable with his act.
Kailangan makuha mo lang isa. Makakuha ka lang ng isa, dalawang tao doon. Mahawa na yun eh. Kasi alam mo agad, ako alam ko agad pagsampa ko kung paano ko sila patatawa. Yung mga bigyan mo lang ako ng 3 minuto, alam ko na.
And those are the top stories amongst the Filipino community in North America. You can catch more of our stories online at news.abs-cbn.com/tfcnews and on the ABS-CBN News YouTube channel. Back to Mike and Nikki for the rundown.
Thank you, TJ. And that's the rundown today. I'm Mike Navallejo. You can watch highlights, recaps, and exclusive content of our shows online.
And I'm Nikki De Guzman. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Now, Head Start comes your way next. Karen Davila will be joined live by Senator J.B. Arecibo. Stay tuned for that here on ANC.